Hi, it's Chris Wallace. I'm pleased to be coming to you today from ASCO 2023 and joined by the Oncology Brothers to give us an update on what they see as the big improvements and advances in clinical care coming out of this year's meeting. So thanks so much for joining us, gentlemen.
Thanks, Chris. I'm Rahul Gosain. I'm one of the general medical oncologists practicing in upstate New York with the University of Rochester in Rochester, New York.
Thanks, Chris. I'm Rohit Gosain. I'm from UPMC Chautauqua Hospital, UPMC Hillman Cancer Center in Jamestown, New York. Excited about ASCO 2023 and here excited to talk to Chris about some of the practice changing stuff that we have been seeing at this conference.
Absolutely. So maybe just to start off very broadly, big takeaways from the meeting. We've got some advances in prostate cancer. I think, you know, first line mCRPC remains a very rapidly evolving disease space. Part clearly being the leading, most interesting disease approach. So what's your takeaway on the new data we're seeing, maybe in the context of the recent FDA guidance as well?
Yeah, just before ASCO 2023, we saw olaparib got approved with abiraterone based on PROPELLED trial. That's exciting because it's giving us more options. However, in the community, we have to be mindful of that these patients are shrinking because we are using a lot of the ADTs, ARIs upfront. So this still remains a big unmet need. We also have to be mindful about some of the side effects that we run into PARP inhibitors when we're managing these patients upfront because now they're exposed to these medications for a longer period of time. And then the other thing that's important is it good enough to use it upfront? Or when we're seeing data with things like TRITON3, where you can use this after progression, what's better? Those are some of the things that we're struggling with, but a lot of data to consume.
Absolutely, and I think maybe it's worth highlighting that the FDA approval is not the same as the way that the PROPEL study was designed.
Absolutely.
So maybe you want to comment both on the PROPEL data and maybe the TALAPRO2 data we saw presented here about, you know, biomarker selection, right, and how we can use that to really guide our treatment choices for our patients.
Right, so to PROPEL data, where it was approved, was BRCA1, BRCA2 positive status. However, in what we see in talazoparib, TALAPRO data, now we are seeing more subgene analysis being conducted where we are seeing more benefit beyond BRCA1, BRCA2, that is HRR positive patient population. But this is all in metastatic castration resistant setting. Now, when we dive into metastatic castration sensitive setting, really, we need to do more work and, of course, bring in some of those therapies down to the earlier line as well.
Absolutely, and that's the ongoing theme in oncology, right? Is test it at the end. If it works, keep moving it forward and find one thing that works and find a second and then try them together. So you kind of highlighted a little bit some of the limitations applying these data to our patients today. You know, TALAPRO2, PROPEL, they were designed in an era where people were really only getting ADT alone.
Absolutely.
For metastatic hormone-sensitive disease. And so do you have a thought on how we apply these data to our patients today who are getting, you know, abiraterone, enzalutamide, apalutamide, maybe even triplet therapy before they progress to castration resistance?
Yeah, and again, to what you've said, it's so good to see how fast this field's evolving. Now we have more and more options. We are even using docetaxel upfront in some selective patients. Abiraterone is being used even in some non-metastatic patients. So we have more and more options, but we have to be mindful extrapolating this data when the readout comes and the field has evolved. So when we're looking at olaparib, when we're looking at talazoparib or rucaparib, you have to keep that in mind and how we apply to each, every patient that's sitting in front of us.
Nice. And it's interesting how the trials have enrolled all comers, where now we are only seeing major benefit that is driven by BRCA1, BRCA2, and HRR positivity. But we have to also stratify the patient population, which is HRR negative, where we are still seeing some benefit, but we don't have any means to define that science aspect of it, what's causing that benefit. Again, a lot of research still needs to happen in that arena.
Actually, coming back to what you're saying, Rohit, that's what, Chris, you were saying, that the PROPEL design versus what the FDA approval is, even though the design included all comers, the approval is for BRCA1, BRCA2. And I think that's important because majority of the benefit in that study was driven in BRCA1, BRCA2 patients.
Absolutely, and we saw some good data out of Spain today at ASCO, really highlighting that the BRCA1, BRCA2 subset is a limited subset of our patient population, though, in that 12, 13, maybe 15% of the patient population groups. So we really want to go and look for those patients,
right,
highlighting the value and the importance of genetic testing in our advanced prostate cancer patients and making sure we're ordering those tests so we can act on the results. Now, outside of prostate cancer, we've seen some pretty big advances in the field of advanced bladder cancer recently, and so maybe I'm interested in your thoughts on what's happening with EV, sort of across a number of indications and disease spaces.
Very true.
Yeah, exciting times because, again, the field continues to advance. We're seeing more options, but EV or EV Pembro particularly just got approved in advanced metastatic bladder cancer. To me, as a general medical oncologist practicing here, that option is so exciting because we are seeing carbo and cisplatin shortage. So that's unfortunate. Mm-hmm. We should be using these drugs because there's stronger data. That is what we're seeing with the cohort K here in EV-103. The phase 3 is ongoing. But again, right now, given the backbone shortage of cisplatin and carboplatin, EV Pembro is a great choice for some of our patients.
And again, when we talk about the safety of, profile of EV and Pembro, we are already used to some of these side effects, that is peripheral neuropathy and immune-related side effects. But again, keeping the fact that peripheral neuropathy comes at a cost there, so keeping this appropriately in mind itself. So.
Absolutely. And you know, we alluded to this in the prostate space, but when you find a good drug and it works later on, you want to move it earlier. And so we're seeing data here at ASCO 2023, looking at the role of EV as a neoadjuvant therapy. And again, probably very relevant given your comments about the cisplatin shortage. We know level one evidence, but we want to give systemic therapy before we take out the bladder. And so I'm interested in your guys' thoughts on the role of EV as that neoadjuvant agent.
Right, that is again a very unmet need where we know that cisplatin ineligible patients, we take them directly for cystectomy. However, that is certainly not the most feasible option when we are dealing with an aggressive disease. In that space, neoadjuvant EV, we see that safety effect profile data looks very impressive. Now we have to see, does it translate into pathological complete response or a decrease in surgical complications for, and again, those results are certainly pending.
And I think as a generalist, you get a chance to see the disease sites from different what's happening. We're seeing this trend in breast cancer. We're seeing this trend in lung cancer. And now here we are talking about bladder cancer. So I think that neoadjuvant approach is going to be very important. The only negative data that so far we've seen with this approach ended up being in pancreatic cancer, mm-hmm. which was actually surprising. Right. So we're eagerly looking forward to this data. Because the other thing is in community, we're actually seeing that carboplatin gets used even in upfront settings, where in academic settings we tend to see a lot more use of cis, rightly so. Mm-hmm. So I think giving that option of EV upfront, taking that out that you have to worry about cis ineligible or platinum ineligible, I really think will be very helpful from our perspective.
Just talking about utilization of carboplatin in neoadjuvant setting, unfortunately, we don't have any strong data for that, so we should, in our conversation in past interviews itself, it has been sort of discouraged to utilize carboplatin, gemcitabine, while cisplatin is a certainly strong agent in this setting. So we should definitely rely on that. And if this patient is cis ineligible, the patient should directly go for cystectomy until unless we have more proof on neoadjuvant setting from EV data.
Absolutely. Well, gentlemen, I want to thank you for your time. Any last pearls you want to leave the audience with before we sign off?
Yeah, coming back, I think we're seeing a lot of advances, but going back home, it is very important to make sure we're testing our prostate cancer patients for germline somatic mutations upfront, because you have actionable targeted agents that you can use, and eagerly looking forward to phase 3 trial for EV Pembro in advanced metastatic bladder cancer.
And just to echo there, certainly that is important for germline somatic mutation, but also for generally in oncology, for targeted therapy. This is important for patient population, all the oncologists, nurse practitioner, or anyone taking care of any of our patients here, that targeted therapy is the key. We need to test more and be more compliant with it so we have more appropriate options for our patient population today.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. Thanks so much for your time, gentlemen.
Chris, thank you for having us.